It's gone to 6 o'clock, I think we'll make a start. If, as I like, everyone can just check with the button and either turn their phones off or on silent, please, so that we don't get any unwanted interruptions. So I'll move on to item one of the agenda, which is apologies for absence. I've got a couple. Apologies from Councillor Blakey and Councillor McLaughlin. We have Councillor Green in for Councillor Blakey and Councillor Davies in for Councillor McLaughlin. And also, Gillian Wood has indicated that she will try to get with us as soon as she can. She had a family emergency. That's everyone else is here. Welcome to everyone. Welcome to Councillor Green for joining us and Councillor Davies. And of course, the Leader of the Council, who's now joining us on this committee. Thank you.
Thank you,
Pat.
You're welcome.
Very reasonable. Still, don't talk about that later. You still
have a
meeting, Pat.
Not
item two, members' code of conduct, declarations of interest. Have any members got any declarations they want to share with us?
Okay. Just like a bit of advice, please, if I may. In terms of council owned companies,
no, not Chair, because the share of the board is more on the council side, not on the other side.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Okay. I think there might be some more questions about that once we actually get to that item anyway. But item three, minutes of the meeting held on the 26th of September. I hope everyone is on site of them. So they look pretty accurate to me. Anyone got any additions or edits they'd like to make? I will accept them as or in favour of accepting them as reasonable accounts.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's agreed.
Item 4, summary of standards complaints set from 2018 to 2019. I think this is Vicky doing this one.
This provides a summary of the standards complaints that we've received from the 31st of October 2018 to the 31st of October this year. The ethical framework requires the complaints are dealt with confidentially, so obviously the amount of information that can be provided is limited. However, I have set out in Appendix 1 a brief summary of the complaints that have been received. And during this period of time, 13 members of the public made 15 complaints in relation to the conduct of 9 members. There was one member of the public who complained about 4 members, and 3 of those complaints were connected in a way. And there have been no complaints by members against other members during this period of time. So I'm happy to answer any questions. I know that the figures always sometimes look a bit strange in this report because it's difficult because, as I say, sometimes people make more and more complaints or they make more and more complaints about more and more members. But I can try and answer any questions.
I've seen there is one that's ongoing.
Next week, and at the moment the matter is exempt.
Don't want to know the name, I just asked. has there been an investigation?
There has
6 months seems a long time.
There has been an investigation, and there have been a number of other factors that have complicated it along the way.
Yes, sir.
I wonder if officers kindly explain something to me. I can understand fail to treat others with respect. What I don't understand is the shorthand of inconsistent duty conduct. What does inconsistent duty conduct encompass? So I would just appreciate if you can, without naming anyone or describing the circumstances.
There are a number of circumstances in which it may be alleged that members have not carried out perhaps certain responsibilities in the way that perhaps a member of the public might have required them to do so. For example, perhaps people have certain expectations as to perhaps the speed within which members would respond to emails and that kind of thing, and sometimes those sort of issues are raised. So I suppose you could argue that is failing to treat somebody with proper respect if you don't respond in a prompt timescale, but I'd probably term it things of that kind of nature as inconsistent duty conduct.
That's an interesting one, that one, actually, because I've had many instances when you actually do reply and then still get shouted at if you're not replying quick enough. But it's hopefully people haven't been submitting complaints about me on that. Okay, just nothing else from anyone?
No.
Okay, we'll move on to, I'm having a bit of a technology breakdown here, so bear with me. We'll move on to item 5. Which is the council on the companies.
Where's this fucking? Forgive me, members, I've got a cold, so there's a bit of a pain saddle after the night being confused in my voice. This is a short report following on discussions at previous meetings where members asked for this detailed lighting. The council is currently a member of 4 companies. Traditional sense of the form. It is also a member of several other companies, some live, some dormant, such, most of which are companies limited by guarantees, such as Mersey Maritime, which is effectively the arm of the of the Chamber of Commerce and some of the learning organisations. There are also in the days of PFI, members may remember that they were set up through quite complicated mechanisms of various single-purpose vehicles. Council was a member of those at that time and no longer has an active shareholding, although they might exist on some books somewhere, but for these purposes are relevant. So there are currently 4 companies which we recognise. Essential, which is a community interest company of which we are a member, provides services to schools. By being a community interest company, its profits are all allowed back into the company, the councils. The 2 councils that own it don't take any profits out. We have Evolutions Limited, which is a wholly owned company, is a trading company, but what's known as a tackle company, in which it is very much controlled by the council as the principal contractor, and all the services are provided back to the council. It comes within a test that means that the work provided to it does not need to be procured. Discussions continue with Rural Evolutions over its business plan. The World Growth Company Nominee Limited, which is entirely dormant, and because what we think of as the World Growth Company actually not a company, it's a partnership, a limited liability partnership. There was always the danger that someone would come along and register the name as a company and then either hold us to ransom or trade in competition with exactly the same name we're using. So we bought the company name merely to own the naming rights, and that's its sole purpose. Otherwise it's a non-trading dormant company. And then Rural Holdings Limited,
questions I've got a couple for yourself. Just with regard to the private companies and the dormant, or the one in particular, we spoke about this anyway, and it's just there to have the name. Are there still costs that we get levied by just having that company, registered with Companies House? And the second one will be on PFI schemes. Are there any liabilities, implication liabilities? So whilst we're not a controlled and interest in that actual company, I'm guessing we're still registered as a shareholder, so would we have potential liabilities if something was to happen with that business?
Going back, Chair, no, all of those sorts of PFI companies are dead, so for all intents and purposes, so people who've been deregistered or dormant, so there's nothing there. In terms of us running a dormant company, I think the fee for annual registration at Companies House and registering dormant company accounts is £13.50. So.
You're probably right in that.
There's no easy way to search Companies House register to see what we are. I did this exercise in previous life as well for another council. Our teams here have done a similar chore. But what tends to happen is that there's a single purpose vehicle that creates a basic shareholding. That then becomes a member of another company, which becomes a member of another company, which becomes another member of another company. Lost in that stream. So there are quite possibly several dormant companies sitting out there with our names on the books that we will never find and never know about, not directly but through the string of a company of which we are a shareholder, then itself as a corporate entity becoming a shareholder of another company. And so it goes on. So they can be multiple streams that we can chase around the world of the financial centres. From those days of quite complex PFI deals, but I can assure you that they are all dormant or have no impact on the council.
I think for anyone who wasn't listening, Phil's just explained how to launder your money.
So that's in there as a fail safe. So I'm just flagging.
can see you're not fully satisfied with that involvement.
No, I'm never the
end.
Oh, it is bizarre actually that for everything that we actually own internally, we haven't been that asset register, but you would think that for any businesses we are associated with, it would be locked with the door. If you shade buy shares, and it's like the doll inside the doll, isn't it? I suppose it goes on forever or could do. Is anyone else?
Yeah, I'm a bit like Paul, really. I don't see how we can let that lie. Just, there might be, we might have businesses with Shell, we kept there and so on and so forth. So which we might not. We might be losing it on our rights to shareholders, possibly, I don't know. But nobody else does because we don't know. And I can't believe that, sorry, this is the fault of the financial system because, things have been sold and so on and so forth. It's our shareholding. We should be keeping a view of it. If the council entered into these arrangements, these complex arrangements which you refer to, then the council had a responsibility to keep a track of where the shareholding went. As an interested party also, you'd want to know who's bought that shareholding and who's there subsequently gone forward. I can remember reports coming where the risk profiles changed, so we got in those days money back because the risk will reduce and it had been so long. And we always took the money with great glee from memory. Those that were in charge took the money with great glee when it was made available. They didn't say, oh well, we'll take the money, but we won't bother finding out who's bought or why the risk has changed. So I just don't think it's a satisfactory answer for an officer to come to us and say, we don't know what you're all doing. There's got to be some sort of responsibility or mechanism to find out, doesn't it?
Chair, I recognise it's not a satisfactory answer. I share in that. There is a risk to cost ratio, as it were, between actually do we need to know all that information, because to find out that we could purchase, there are search agents out there that cost considerable amounts of money to effectively go through search processes compared to what's the risk. So if as committee you want us to undertake that further work and get quotes for those search agents to see what it may or may not be out there.
Well, forgive me, Chair, but, and again, I'm a guest, so I'm more interested in other items on the agenda than I'm a guest, but it strikes me, how many schools do we have at PFI? Was it four or something? Okay. So we start off with eight or nine complicated ones, then we track it through. I don't think we should just, shrug our shoulders, it's complicated. We should be able to find out, shouldn't we? That's all. And if it needs another paper about, how on earth did the string snap in the first place? Who suddenly decided not going to bother following this up, the history of it? I think that would in itself be useful. It might help us with a lesson learned, so an officer doesn't have to come back to us at some point in the future. So you asked how many, shareholders we got, And I would have thought, we involved in a pension fund. I would imagine a pension fund has some expertise around doing this sort of thing. So I don't know whether it is as straightforward as saying, it's all very expensive and the risk and all that stuff. We must have expertise within this arena to find out.
If there is a risk stroke cost analysis to be carried out, is that something that we need to engage the 151 officer with as well? So actually, I'm just trying to pattern this off on you, Ronald. Is it something that...
Well, is there some organ we don't
know? Exactly, which is always quite worrying.
It's like the disappearing PO numbers,
allegedly. But is that something that we have to engage 151 officer?
Chair, obviously this report is ostensibly about the active companies which were engaged in, and that as you say, is something that's overly dominant, because there is, for example, there's a maritime company. It is a piece of work we can go away and have a look at. One would think that there would be a facility of Companies House to actually search for by a shareholder how many companies. Unfortunately, it doesn't work like that. Wish it did, because it is frustrating. But I'm happy to go away and undertake an investigation of that piece of work, because myself, I'm quite curious for all the reasons the council agreement.
Okay, are we satisfied? I'll go Phil Sayer for the report.
I think the problem we'll have, because we get older, my friend Stuart, is that, and because membership changes, because officers have had a huge turnover due to retirement in recent years, that there's a collective memory that isn't there intact. Well, of course, we do know one way of seeing what's has an extensive collective memory, and that officer might be asked if there's anything in that officer's memory, not naming him. However, because we've been through so many different regeneration schemes, you might wonder whether the things hanging off the edge that weren't closed down, shut or boxed off, or passed on with time. And in the time that Council Greenbank on the council. Whole range of things. Well, it was City Labs, which I served on for a bit. Hamilton Quarter, which I served on till I was thrown off, because I complained about certain things. Lillard Side, which came and went. Things like New Wallasey, which even rented hotel accommodation in Wallasey for a period of time, for example. Whole range of things which have come and gone, which we haven't got skeletons in the cupboards along there, but we haven't got some liability for some site that we're involved with cleaning up or acquiring or doing something with that might suddenly bite us on the back when somebody finds that it's dangerous or they were injured on it and then they start tracing the worms. So the only thing we can certainly say is that hand on the heart. All the people involved in Hamilton Quarter, all those organisations, closed them down successfully at the time, passed their records on to officers, and then they fired someone from in the basement of Cheshire Lines or some other place.
We had to spend a fortune on the archives, but I thought the best solution was truly plenty of space.
Well, we spent about £250,000 on the archives, Councillor Green, and Cheshire Lines is going away, I hope it might be. We will have to find a home for materials there when we build our new offices, not forgetting that aspect of it. So I think that there will be, hopefully, some people whose memory can be tapped before it becomes impossible to tap their memories any further.
Chair, I'm quite happy to take away as an action from this committee to undertake a historical exercise in relation to where we may be a member of a dormant or potentially dissolved historical company and other companies beyond the active ones that are listed here, to take that away as a project for somebody. If it becomes too deep, too expensive, I'll then come bring that back here and say, but actually it's something, as I said, we should be able to make a decent start off and undertake that historical exercise. To satiate our own curiosity and potential liabilities.
Reputation, potential, Chair. But what if we've got one of these companies? If one of these companies had bought another company, bought another company, and the holding company ends up being a company that wouldn't want to be associated with as a local authority. So it's not just the financial liabilities, it's reputation. We don't know.
Chair, we'll take that away as an exercise. It may take a little while because it's something we'll run along on the back burner, and certainly is the kind of project that we can give to intellectual trainees and others to try and avoid costs of going to search companies if we can.
I think that's a that piece of work from May of this year, and last full council meeting, you all unanimously agreed to move to a committee system. So the ongoing governance review is now moved into a different phase, which is basically the rewrite of the constitution and the setting up of the committee system and the structure. This is an ongoing piece of work. There's been some behind the scenes workshops with spokes and myself, and they will continue. And the idea is to bring a report to March, full council, for all members to be appraised on. But before then, we are systematically reviewing it, and we're here today with this current status. So, without further ado, Phil.
Thank you, Chair. I thought easier for easier for members to present this as a set of slides. Something we talked to for two reasons. One, because it's something that members can see where you're at in terms of the government's working group, the decisions and principles to be made. But also, this has a double purpose in the Local Government Association visited us last Monday and met with the group leaders, and they attended with the Centre for Public Scrutiny, their own lead officers, and the lead regional peer from each of the political parties to test out where we got to and to test out what assistance they can give. So this has served a double purpose. Sorry, is it? This is the update, of course. The principal thing to say is that to get this done in the time frame that we've got, there is a project group. We're assisted by someone from the project management office in that. We have five separate work streams which in themselves are split into different projects, and different people have responsibility for different things. So Steve Fox over there is dealing with the Centre for Public Scrutiny in terms of training. Is also dealing with the publication and consultation side, because you've got a responsibility under your common constitution that you're changing these systems that go out to consultation. The process there is that we're obliged to put out a public notice. That public notice has also pointed members to a web page that's being set up. That web page will keep updated. So this, for example, will go on to the web page and will invite members of the public to contact us and say whether they would like to learn on learning on what they picked up from the forms. Constitution rewrite is the larger piece of work to put that in place, but obviously the first phase for you is the committee redesign. We've been busy researching and contacting other councils that have been through this process. I met last week the head of governance from London Borough of Redbridge. They went to the committee system this May, so they're in their now third meeting cycle of it running. And today they sent me a copy of everything that they used in the run-up to that conversation. Quite interestingly, they've got the smallest number of committees of any of the council. They've got policy and resources and then only three service committees, so that's quite tight. Thursday I'm meeting again colleagues from Cheshire East, because they're now running on a similar timeline to ourselves, so they're looking to go in May. They had a longer run-up, but in some ways because we planned on with a couple of steps ahead of them, so we're trying to do things as best as we can. Service review and staffing redesign is something that will come, because once we know actually how many committees you've got, how they're going to be designed, then we need to build a staffing structure around it. scheme, we are on track for recruiting a new independent remuneration panel so that at the extraordinary meeting at the beginning of January, we'll be able to recommend to you names for appointment, and then they can get on with the job of looking at a new members allowance scheme that you can adopt in time for May. So these are the meetings you've had thus far, which have set those milestones. So 28th of October was the outcomes from the council decision. 4th of November, the governance group agreed on principles for drafting and outcomes. So I'm able to go back and check with you that if I'm writing this stuff, this is how it's going to be done. And in terms of resourcing that writing, I know that we set against it a potential cost. And in looking at how it could be done, other councils have simply gone out to buy the practice and written a check and said, can we buy someone in to do this work with you? Obviously, we're all aware that actually that is what I did in private practice. So the cheapest way of doing things is for me to do it, but then in to buy any support and actually to buy in any backfill for when I can't be doing other work because I'm doing this. Currently, we're on track for that with a little delay in the last week or so because there's this thing called an election coming up, which is taking a little bit of organising and involvement. The 11th of November was the last key meeting, which looked at design iteration and then tonight. There are a number of slides here. There's three really important ones. This is important, which is that for you as members and ourselves, we keep coming back and asking these questions at each phase and each iteration of what we do, which is returning back to those objectives, those six objectives that you and the council agreed on. What's then produced actually look like? Are we living those objectives in terms of the design? Actually, what does that mean then in terms of practical implications for the rest of the council and how the council actually goes about doing its business? For example, seeing a project through from beginning to end. And then the thing we keep returning to is how does that impact on the culture? Because the reasons that you as members said you wanted to do this is to change the culture of the council. And actually, it will be a fairly simple task to do this and not change the culture at all. So to go back again to those objectives, which is to see the council running in a different way. And so sometimes it's much about the processes and the custom and practice that's behind some of the things that the council does, as much as the big headline forms of government. If you remember that design I did in the previous workshops of the two parks, with the open and closed councils and how actually a committee system can be very closed. So practical questions that were asked, which is how does it all work? Some of the back to basics of actually what is it that members and officers do, what are we all here for, and as part of that training for officers, because with the committees there will be a new generation of officers coming before committees who won't have done so before. So we're starting, for example, tomorrow with a drop-in session on the political awareness and actually what is this? What are the roles, going right back to basics of about different things. The design of the committees, how overview and scrutiny works and that relationship between the committees and
overview and scrutiny?
Yes.
Sorry, I thought we'd gone to the programme committee.
No, that's not the same thing.
So size and frequency of meetings, and then of course always asking, as I mentioned before, what do other councils do. So second big one, those objectives. So accountability, credibility, transparency, collaboration, and timeliness to be able to be a business council and get business done. Quick recap,
which is the committee system operates under the Local Government Act 1972, so it's not quite as it was before. There are still elements of the Local Government Act 2000 which we have to adhere to, so there is a new set of regulations. So we go through a slight process. So the basics are the Local Government Act 1972, but in terms of executive functions, we have adopted a committee system for the Local Government Act 2000, which then takes us to a set of regulations by which the council must operate. So, for example, there is still the concept of major policies that must be reserved to full councils, which wasn't the case under the Commission 72. Council may arrange for the discharge of its functions through committee, subcommittee, or an officer, always a single person, not a group of people, and allocation of seats on political balance principles, and then the four principles which we get to, which is how we work in committees. At the moment, this committee is permitted through those exceptions, but the other regulatory and administrative committees work through that at the moment. There are certain exceptions, and with this group being part of it, that drop-in session. And then the process that the working group has gone through, which is to say, okay, well, you want to change the culture, you want to do that through adopting a committee system, actually doing it with one's eyes open as to actually there are some disadvantages to the committee system as was, and mitigating those risks through adopting the kind of committee system that we want to do. So, just a reminder of that, those risks being can be a weakening of strategic leadership and direction through silos-based thinking, and without naming names, there are those councillors who now say this is a problem for them in operating a committee system. A lack of openness and transparency, because much of the decision-making was then made within the political groups through the whip system, and so actually one argument for having gone to a cabinet system in the first place was to overcome some of that governance and transparency, so it is slowing down of decision making when things in the previous systems went through various committees, increased bureaucracy and holding to account. So those are risks, all of which by having the working group discussed those things actually can be overcome. So that mitigation being that there is cross-party support for a proportionate system engaging all members, the recognition of the council as the supreme decision-making body, and therefore members, all members play a part in key strategic decisions, and one of the things that the working group has yet to address its mind to is actually what those things would need to be. So the reserving to full council of the major policies, what are those? Because at the moment, certain major policies are reserved to full council as a matter of law. That's extremely minimal, very minimal. So, children's plan, finding the sort of strategy level plan, pretty much it. So actually there were a great number of other strategies and concepts such as the council plan itself, you know, its own annual business plan, one of the things that could be reserved for council, and actually that list needs to be discussed and developed as one of the pieces of work to be done. The separation in responsibility between regulatory committees and policy committees, so for example the planning, as in development control planning, so there is the steer from the working group was that there is to be retained a regulatory committee for development control decisions and a planning policy committee for developing planning policy, but those are done in two different places, so there is that continual focus. And of course, at the moment, there is already a local plan advisory group, which
not to be a nostalgic return to the traditional committee system, but is to try and retain the best of what is an open cabinet system, and there was a recognition that what this council has had over the last few years, not this year, but in previous years, I believe the comments made by members, was not an open cabinet system, so that decisions are accountable, but the council can also be reactive and commercial where it needs to be, and then making use of those open scrutiny and call-in principles to enable that to happen. So where that takes the decisions thus far is that council takes a decision on the full list of reserve policies and deferred decisions, but otherwise has a very firm and strict series of delegations to a policy and resources committee, which takes a role of delegated authority for key strategic decision making within the budget and policy framework, able to make decisions quickly and to foster the rating, and the focus is on strategic leadership, not operational management, but often on the recommendation of functional committees, or what we call policy and services committees, what I would refer to as doing and reviewing, which is designed to do two things in an understandable way, so they are. There is considerable discussion over what they're called, which may sound a light discussion, but actually for members of the public to look at the council and go, yes, I understand that's where these decisions are going to be made, then that's it. So they will have delegated authority to make decisions within that policy framework and the budget according to them by PNR, but also that they have what are now known as the overview and scrutiny functions within looking at the council itself in terms of reviewing policy, formulating policy and recommending policy on PNR and on to full council. So they undertake those roles. There is then a single overview and scrutiny committee which may or may not contain health, that's part of the discussion, but that